I welcome you all in the live discussion of answers of test practice given earlier. We will see the detailed explanation of each and every questions in this video. So keep watching. The first question is an enzyme catalyzed reaction was measured in the presence and absence of an inhibitor for an uncompetitive inhibition. So we have to know how many types of inhibitor are there which can inhibit the enzyme catalyzed reaction. In this regard, we have answered that there can be competitive inhibition, non-competitive inhibition, or there can be uncompetitive inhibition. If we see the competitive inhibition, their inhibitors binds competitively with the enzyme. In the non-competitive inhibition, inhibitor binds with enzyme as well as enzyme substrate complexes. But in the uncompetitive inhibition, if we will see the uncompetitive inhibition, in this, if we have the equation enzyme plus substrate that form enzyme substrate complex, that is forming enzyme plus product, then in the case of uncompetitive inhibition, inhibitor binds with the enzyme substrate complex, and as a result both Km and Vmax get decreased. Km and Vmax, that is Michaelis Menten as well as maximal velocity, gets decreased in uncompetitive inhibition. Second question is, that is, glucose residue in amylose are linked by. We already know the correct answer of this question is alpha-1,4-glycosidic bond. But we should know where amylose are present. So amylose is present in both starch as well as glycogen. From previous knowledge, we know starch is a reserved carbohydrate materials in the case of plants, and glycogen is the reserved carbohydrate material in animals. And we also know starch and glycogen are the branched polysaccharide, that is, it has the branching of alpha-1,6, and the linear chain of polysaccharide is joined by alpha-1,4, and this alpha-1,4 in both cases, either it is the starch or glycogen, alpha-1,4 it forms amylose part, and the branch, that is the alpha-1,6, it forms amylopectin. So alpha-1,6 part forms amylopectin, and alpha-1,4 part, in both cases starch as well as glycogen, it forms amylose. The next question is question 3, that is, proton motive force during oxidative phosphorylation is generated in mitochondria by which process? So the correct answer we already know that is oxidative phosphorylation. Proton motive force generated due to the process of pumping protons into intermembrane space. The intermembrane space is the space between the outer mitochondrial membrane and inner mitochondrial membrane. We already know this is the outer mitochondrial membrane and This is the inner membrane. And the space in between both is known as intermembrane space. Intermembrane space, or we can say perimitochondrial space. When the reaction of when the electron transport chain is running in the inner mitochondrial membrane by the help of electron transport chain, simultaneously when the electron transport chain is running there in the inner mitochondrial membrane, some proton molecules get assembled in the intermembrane space. When these proton molecules get released into the matrix again, oxidative phosphorylation process takes place, and as a result ATP gets formed. So we have to know only where the proton motive force is generated. So the correct answer is proton motive force is generated due to the accumulation of proton ions, and that accumulation occurs in the intermembrane space. And this proton accumulation occurs during the process of electron transport chain, that is ETC, electron transport chain occurring in the inner mitochondrial membrane. Next question is question number 4. If lactose and glucose are provided in the growth medium of a culture of E. coli, what will happen? So we have to know, in E. coli, to metabolize lactose, there's an lac operon system. That is, lactose is degraded into glucose plus galactose. Lactose is degraded into glucose plus galactose. If we provide already glucose in the medium, then why the lac operon will function? If we provide already glucose in the medium, if the glucose is already present, then why lac operon will function? There's no need of functioning of lac operon. So if glucose are provided in the growth medium, lactose operon will not be transcribed. So the correct answer and explanation of this question is option 2. Next question is multi-enzyme complex of TCA cycle. Multi-enzyme complex means what? The enzyme which is made up of multiple subunit. And we already know the correct answer of this question is option 4, that is pyruvate dehydrogenase. Now we will see what subunits are constituting pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. Pyruvate dehydrogenase complex is made up of 3 individual enzymes. Pyruvate dehydrogenase is an assembly of 3 individual enzymes, pyruvate dehydrogenase, that is E1 plus dihydrolipoyl transacetylase E2 plus E3, dihydrolipoyl dehydrogenase, that is E3. So we can clearly see pyruvate dehydrogenase is made up of multiple subunit. So it can also be said that it is a multi-enzyme complex. E1 means pyruvate dehydrogenase, E2 means dihydrolipoyl transacetylase, E2 means dihydrolipoil trans acetylase that catalyzes transfer of acetyl group to coenzyme A, and E3 means dihydrolipoil dehydrogenase that reoxidizes dihydrolipoamide Next question is question number 6. Which of the following is true? So we already know the correct answer is option 1. That is, disulfide bridges formed by oxidation of sulfhydryl groups on cysteine stabilizes protein tertiary structure. We already know cysteine is a sulfur containing amino acids, and disulfide bonds is formed by the process of oxidation. And from the previous knowledge, we know that primary structure comprises peptide bond only. Secondary structure of protein comprises peptide bond as well as a hydrogen bond. Tertiary structure comprises covalent and some non-covalent bonds, and the only covalent bond that is stabilizing tertiary structure is disulfide bond. So SS bond or disulfide bond is a covalent bond formed by oxidation of SH group, that is sulfhydryl group. SS bond or disulfide bond is a covalent bond formed by oxidation of sulfhydryl groups. We will try our best to update each and every aspects of CSIR NET pattern questions here. Thank you. Wish you all the best.